And the full title of it is Active Hope, How to Face the Mess We're In Without Going Crazy. One of the key themes in this book is what happens when we link arms and start talking together and acting together for the sake of life on Earth. And that theme is the principle of emergence and synergy. Well, we certainly discovered that in working together. Now, if you had been with me years back, you would be astonished that I would be co-authoring a book with the word hope in it. You would, might have heard me say, hope is a killer. Hope is wishful thinking. Hope takes you out of the immediate situation. Hope takes you out of the moment. Yes, and in Buddhist thought and practice, is there a word hope? No, there isn't. It's because you are right with what is, and you don't journey off in what you want to have happen. So that's the way I used to be and talk. But somehow, how did this hope get into the title of our book? From the beginning.
I suggested it. and you said you liked the title.
Well, see, everything changes. I would like to address first what were the big, exciting learnings for me, discoveries for me. So don't think that when you're sitting down to write a book, you take what you know and you put it on paper or on the screen. It's starting out on a voyage of discovery, and you might be lucky enough to discover what you need to know or deserve to know. So a discovery right off the bat for me was that, and what freed me for writing a book of this title, was in the very earliest conversations, because it became clear to us that hope is not something you have, it's something you do. It's not a noun, it's a verb. Or, and I've just come from doing this work for 4 weeks in Germany, and there's a motto that grew up around, it's grown up around this book that says, Hoffnung entsteht im Handeln. Hope arises in action. So you don't wait around taking your pulse. Am I hopeful or am I a pessimist? Today I'm feeling more pessimistic than hopeful. Or I'm feeling helpless, hopeless today. So, in my country, the United States of America, I have always noted there's been an exaggerated notion of the importance of hope. And we, as a matter of fact, think that hope and success are very closely tied. That the successful and competent person or politician is someone who is brimming with optimism and smiles a lot. And the little smiley face you stick on places, I think that that's an American product, don't you? So I have noticed that this is, can be, to think of something as hope is something that you need to have in order to get going and keep going. I've noticed that it can get in the way. That you can wait around until you're feeling optimistic. And then you think that if you're not feeling, if you're feeling hopeless at a moment, oh, then that's a problem. But oh, my dears, you know that hopefulness and hopelessness are just feelings that come and go. And so I loved it when we got clear with each other from the get-go that active hope is something that you can engage in for the sake of our world, for the sake of the healing of our world, for the sake of the great turning to a life-sustaining society. You can engage in it and you can take action even when you're feeling pessimistic. Now I want you, sort of hoping that you can heave a sigh of relief. you don't need to be brimming with optimism and convinced of your hopefulness in order to have an adventure that's waiting for you to take part in our journey for the sake of all beings, for life to go on this planet. The other big discovery for me was, and it's always a question of degree, but boy, this degree was big, was how important is a choice at any point? And that this is indeed a miracle. That we, even when it doesn't seem that the scope of our free choice is huge, there's always a choice in how we respond, in the next step we take. I should say that for me, this work called The Work That Reconnects, and we wrote this book in order to be able to share it with a more mainstream audience, readership, has grown up out of my now 50 decades of activism and my work with general systems theory and my work as a teacher of comparative religion and particularly Buddhist thought and practice. So the basic web of cognitive assumptions, or to use another metaphor, the basic wellspring for this work in my life has been systems thinking and Buddhist thought and practice, as well as all the passions and bruises that come from a lifetime on the barricades or knocking on doors or getting petitions or talking at hearings or, you know, a life of where it's felt like nothing would be more satisfying to do than to be able to really take part and link arms with other people to do something about this mess we're in. So what struck me about choice as we did this book is in the, and I'll start with the first chapters and the last, is that perhaps as important as any other choice that we have before us is our choice in how we understand what's happening in our world. And we put that in terms of three stories or three versions of reality or three perspectives on what's happening now. And we lay them out and we say, each one of us, these are three ways that what's the drama of our world in the early third millennium is, and boy, the stakes are high, is in these three stories. So I'm gonna lay them out for you and share with you the gladness that I found in being able to see these as simply ways we choose to understand rather than having to brow people into the right way of acting and be going on the only morally valid path or posture, but that you can leave it open to the choice and without the need to browbeat or persuade. So this will give you a sense of it. So we lay out three stories. These stories are versions of all things that are happening right now.
They're all real.
they're like concentric circles. And as you move out to the second and third, you can see the others. But when you're in the first one, you don't see the others. So the three are business as usual. That's the, and we use a lot the term industrial growth society. That's a term that we borrow from Sigmund Kvaløy, a Norwegian deep ecologist. And I like that term because it says it all. It's driven by industrial power, and it's, but the most, the fatal term is growth, that this is, its goals are set and its success is measured in terms of how fast the growth. So that's the first. The second story is the great unraveling. And that's a phrase borrowed from economist David Corton. And then the third story is the great turning. And actually, I think we took David's great unraveling phrase from his book on the great turning. So these were the three stories, just a word about each one. But you have a choice, you see. Always you have this choice. So let's look at, of course, business as usual. The industrial growth society. This is the story that you hear from the politicians. And if you're in my country and you're running for office and you dare to question the dogma of economic growth, then you're doomed to failure. You're not taken seriously. So it's what you hear from the politicians, what you hear from the corporate leadership, corporations, what you hear from the military. Though sometimes it's interesting, they're beginning the military, beginning to question it now. And what you hear from the media, the corporate controlled media. So for a lot of people, that's the only story there is. And there's just a tremendous moral psychic impact of having this be what is considered normal and inevitable. So whatever's happening, that view is things will be okay once we get back to growth. Growth in what? Health? Wisdom? Beauty? Come on, growth in what? Productivity, fertility. It's just one thing. Corporate profits. Profits and market share. So when you have an open system, a self-governing system, it self-governs, self-regulates by balancing. And you cannot keep a open system and balance when you're always trying, only one factor is always has to be maximized, trumps all the others. Can't, and so it just goes into increasing oscillations and heading toward collapse. But that doesn't, I think maybe future generations, if there are future generations, will be able to look back at this growth mania as one of the most historically diluted periods of the human journey. That we could think that we could keep on growing in a world with finite limits. So, but that is the main story that we hear through the media. There, but that second story, the great unraveling, that is the story that you hear from those who dare to look under the carpet and see what this business as usual is costing us, and is costing us the world. And so it's the scientists and the activists and brave journalists who are reporting what this cost is. The spasms of the extinctions of plant and animal species, the poisoning and the dying of the seas, the silting in of the rivers, the droughts, the floods, the climate chaos becoming more extreme as time goes on, ever more. The spreading of hunger and disease, the huge disparities in food and health, and well, you know, you wouldn't be here, you wouldn't be walking into the Gaia Foundation, and you wouldn't be knowing each other if you weren't pretty aware that of this tremendous spectacle that we are confronted with. It seems to be telling us that we're running out of time and that it can't go on like this. And I like David Corton's phrase, the great unraveling, because that's what systems do. They don't just fall over dead. They begin to unravel. They lose their coherence. They begin to lose their differentiation. They begin to come apart. I was just talking about how I'd like to be able to give a lecture about this, because I do even in the workshops. If I were wearing a pulley, a scent jacket with a loose thread, and then I'd walk around and it would begin to unravel, but I would pretend not to notice it. At any rate, this is what's is happening to ecosystems, it's happening to cultural systems, and languages. It's happening to the very fabric of our culture as well as the web of life. So that's the second story. But there's a third one. And that's the story that is followed and being created and being seen and being nourished by all those who see the great unraveling but refuse to let it have the last word. And this is the story of the great transition, an epical transition from an industrial growth society to a life-sustaining society. Now, my dear friends, this is the way we have lived for most of our journey on planet Earth. We know that. In our book here, there's a wonderful map of time that shows what it looks like, 24-hour period, looking at our universe. Is it universe or a planet? No, our planet. And a 24-hour period looking at our journey as humans. And you see then, I mean, just take, we've lived Homo sapiens, 250,000 years, divide that up into 24 hours, draw it like this, big 24-hour day, starting at midnight. And we were hunter-gatherers for 95% of that time. And as we come around to midnight, the industrial growth society is just seconds, right? In the last 20 seconds, we've used up more than ever has been used up by people on Earth. I think you should gasp. So when we choose to say, oh, this isn't in the media, this isn't being on the evening news very much, it's not on the headlines in the paper, but it's going on and I will find out about it, and then you begin to look on, it's like putting a pair of glasses on And you see that this is a revolution that is taking place in our time. And that it is, some call it, and I agree with Paul Hawken in his book, Blessed Unrest, when he said, this is the largest social movement in human history. There are millions of grassroots organizations that are devoted to finding healthy, non-life-exterminating ways of living together, using human ingenuity and using human passions to find our way home and to turn this planet again into a garden. My gratitude is not dim that I am so lucky as to be able to be alive at this time. I mean, would you really want all this to be happening for your people and you away somewhere, dead or on another planet or in a coma or what? Wouldn't you want to be on hand?
Yes!
You can recognize the great turning because there's sort of three distinctive arenas, and you may be involved in all of them. But there's the arena of the actions to slow down the destruction being wrought by the Industrial Growth Society. And that's all the legislation and regulatory and political activity and legal activity to save what's left, save the species that are left, save some of the gene pool for the life-sustaining society. Boy, that's really, as that takes it out, yeah, you just kind of get beat up doing that, you know. Those of you who have been on the front lines, or those of you who've been engaged in, whether it's preserving the forests or the trying to stop the wars, all these, just slow down that unraveling. But even if they were all victories, it wouldn't be enough for the great turn. Because you have to have new ways of doing things for a life-sustaining society. And so the second arena of the great turning is new ways of doing things, new structures, some of them old structures, alternative structures. And I don't think there's ever been a time in our planet, in our history, where so many new ways of doing things are sprouting up like green shoots through the rubble. New ways of generating energy, new ways of holding the land, new ways of growing the food, new ways of distributing the food, new ways of assessing what prosperity is, indices of sustainability, alternative currencies, et cetera, et cetera. It's astonishing. And I think it's time we think about it, we gasp again. Oh, it's just amazing. So much, so much. And you know, there's absolutely, once you open your eyes to see this, there's absolutely no excuse to be bored. But that's not enough for the great turning either, because those new ways of doing things, new ways of growing food and new ways of solving conflicts, that they're going to shrivel and die unless they're deeply rooted in our visions of reality and our values and how we see ourselves and our relation to each other, to our planet. And so this is a shift in consciousness that is happening now. And as I said, I just love the way the Gaia Foundation works at those first two dimensions of the great journey, but never loses sight of the transformational vision that must arise in and through us, that this is a living planet. The Industrial Growth Society treats it like a supply house and a sewer, and it is not. It is a living body on which everything we ever known and ever have and will be is dependent. And so we find ourselves coming back to an apprehension of meanings and of the sacred that our fathers and mothers have had, and that indigenous, I talk these fathers and mothers, you know, in terms of ancestral lines, and the indigenous voices are there for us today, for us to catch hold again on the basic terms of our sanity. So we can choose that at any moment. And it doesn't have to, and then when you realize that you can choose the story you're going to be part of, that's such a threat. You don't have to wait and say, well, what are the chances? I think it looks like unraveling to great turning is 80-20 today. You don't do that. Are you, when you're with your child or your mother who's sick and dying, you say, well, I might spend some time with my sick baby if I think there's a 50-50 chance of her survival. You don't do that. Because your being there is in itself transformative. And what you discover being with the one who is ailing and even our earth is that something of a deep knowing arises in you. And you realize that you're the luckiest person ever, that you could be here at a time when you could taste the quality of your love for this place. And that that is the sweetest, sweetest thing. And so then you realize that the odds don't matter. That you're here to use your hands and your eyes and your heart. Now I'm going to close saying that there are two words in this book that come from Buddhist teachings and practice. And only one of the authors is Buddhist, but the one who is not in Buddhist practice, this addiction specialist with the medical degree, says we must have these two words because we don't have an English equivalent. And they are bodhisattva. Bodhisattva is the hero in the Buddhist tradition. She or he is the one who knows that we are so interconnected that there is no private salvation. Or the one with a boundless heart. The one who doesn't count the chances. Oh, am I up for it or I'm not? It's just, this is my opportunity to come alive and recognizing my belonging to this earth. And the second term was bodhicitta. And bodhicitta is the intention of the bodhisattva. And we found ourselves using it more and more here because that is a possibility for every single one of us and is probably already, like they call it, like a flame in your heart. It's in your heart that is illuminating so much of what you do in this time that it is the intention, the motivation to act for the sake of all beings. So it's just a moving out into a wider frame. And when you taste what that's like, then it's such a satisfying meaning that you don't want to use.